Tonight on Wings, take off with the Discovery Channel in the Douglas AD Sky Raider. A carrier-based dive bomber and torpedo plane, the Sky Raider evolved into one of the most versatile aircraft ever deployed by the U.S. military. The post-World War II design saw service in several variations in both Korea and Vietnam. The Sky Raider's ability to carry a wide assortment of weapons made it a devastating ground attack aircraft. Tonight, soar high in the Douglas AD Sky Raider on Wing. Some planes have short lifetimes, generally because they reflect the needs of their era. A very few remain in service for so long that they seem permanent. This plane stayed around long enough to be three planes. It was initially the BT-2D, then it was the AD, and then it was the A-1. It was such a success that the only major criticism leveled at it was that not enough were built. The first Douglas Sky Raider, known then as the Destroyer II, took off in March 1945, beginning a service career that was to stretch, unbroken, to Vietnam. After the last U.S. Navy A-1 combat missions were flown, the plane was still being used ashore by the United States and South Vietnamese Air Forces. Where or when the last Sky Raider in combat service flew a mission is somewhat of a mystery. It's probable that they were in use in the African state of Chad as recently as 1979. Even as the Sky Raider was in development, it was already widely believed to be obsolete. After all, it was designed and constructed at the same time as the development of jet engine aircraft in an era that was obsessed with speed. While other designers were scratching their heads about the best way to get around the sound barrier, Douglas engineers were wrestling old-fashioned problems with propellers and radial engines. Nobody questioned that the design was a pinnacle of piston-powered aviation, but many questioned the need for climbing that pinnacle. In hindsight, it can be seen that the Sky Raider was the sum of an enormous bank of knowledge built up over time. In 1925, just 20 years before the first flight of the Sky Raider, the U.S. Navy had one aircraft carrier. By 1935, this figure had only increased to four. Naval aviation was an experimental area. There was no debate about the use and worth of these big ships, but the navies of the world still assessed each other's strength in the number and caliber of battleship guns deployed. Through the 20s and 30s, the numbers of ships and planes slowly increased. Experimentation and testing went a long way toward sorting out the systems, methods, and value of naval aviation. The increasing sophistication and expertise of the crews soon demonstrated telling points in the debate about the function and worth of carriers. It became evident to many that the future of naval conflict would be dominated by air power. Pearl Harbor not only settled all arguments from the die-hard battleship supporters. In the Pacific, it also settled the matter in a practical way. For the moment, the only American force of real power capable of action was the carriers. At the outbreak of war, the carrier complements were, as usual, in transition. It was a major turning point in aviation, with monoplanes taking over from the trusty biplanes. As war started, the planes in use were quickly shown to have major flaws. War demanded different specifications. Fortunately, the conflict in Europe gave a short but significant lead time to aircraft designers, and production was already underway on new, more effective planes. Curtiss Hell Divers and Grumman Avengers were to carry the bulk of the weight of war for the U.S. ships. These followed the established pattern of two-seat dive bombers and three-seat torpedo bombers. The Hell Diver, ordered in 1939 and first flown in 1940, became the standard Navy dive bomber of the last 2 years of the war. But throughout its career, it was troublesome and displayed several flaws. Among these were instability, an operational range of only 250 miles, and poor maintenance access. The plane had not lived up to expectation as a load carrier or for its short takeoff ability. But the Hell Divers were the best planes available for the job, and they were used to good effect. On the other hand, the Grumman Avenger torpedo bombers were a great success. The planes they were to replace, the aging Douglas Devastators, were so outdated that the Avengers were ordered to full production even before the prototype flew. The gamble paid off. With a 2,000-pound bomb or torpedo load, the Avengers, when they went into service, were invaluable, and they were to stay with the fleet until 1954. Another message was also loud and clear. The layout of attack and bomber aircraft had become outdated. The speed and firepower of fighters was such that there was no way for bombers to protect themselves. Their gunners were no deterrent to fighter attack. They needed to depend on their own fighter escorts for control of the sky. This meant there was no real point in the wasted weight of revolving gun turrets. The load would be better carried as fuel and bombs. Despite casualties, there is no doubt that America's naval strength, based on her carriers, dominated the vast Pacific battlefield. Japan lost 39 battleships and cruisers during the war, and only four of these were sunk by American surface ships. Eight more were dealt with by submarines, and the rest, 27, were dispatched by carrier-based planes. Naval aviation was clearly one of the most powerful weapons at America's disposal, and plans were developing to meet needs far beyond the war's end. New, reliable, and powerful engines were available. Experience made it possible to predict accurately the behavior of a design shape. Combat indicated that the gunner was a redundant concept, and in the same way, the observer or bombardier was wasted in a specialized airframe. The next specification for a Navy attack plane to be issued was for a single-seat aircraft. Douglas had been working on their submission, the BTD-1, from 1942. But it was clear that the plane, essentially a pre-war design, was no match for its competitors, including the formidable Martin AM1. While war went on, the situation came to a head on the 16th of June, 1944, at a meeting between the heads of the Douglas team and Navy representatives. The chief designer of the Douglas Navy plant, Ed Heinemann, asked for permission to cancel the plane and use the contract's unexpended funds on a new aircraft. In their hotel, overnight, he and two assistants, working on the basis of the knowledge they had gained in the years since designing the VTD, came up with the outlines for a new plane. The sketches they presented the next morning, accompanied by their technical explanation, intrigued and impressed the Navy's representatives. Douglas was, in effect, allowed to re-enter the competition. They had only 9 months to get their plane into the air, and it had to comply with very tight and unforgiving specifications. It was, in fact, 9 months and one day late to its first flight. About an hour after takeoff, the test pilot was back on the ground, enthusiastic about the plane. It had exceeded his expectation, as it was to exceed the expectations of many people during its lifetime. But the war was drawing to a conclusion. Douglas, having produced the goods, faced the prospect of the market disappearing. Wartime contracts for 548 planes were canceled. Three were delivered in 1945, and only another 22 in 1946. But this minimal production saved the Sky Raider. Though the future of a piston engine aircraft seemed questionable, this plane was clearly something to be reckoned with. And in 1947, the Navy purchased 239 in three different versions. In time, the new plane would operate in many other roles: ambulance, ECM platform, RPV or drone director, target tow, anti-submarine warfare aircraft, night fighter plane, rescue helicopter escort, early warning radar platform, and even as a transport seating 12 passengers. In all, there were to be around 30 major types and about the same number of subtypes. The Sky Raider never ran out of uses.
The 82 was a very stable aircraft. It was not difficult to fly. In fact, a checkout from going from one plane to another, going from training command, where I flew Corsairs, to the A2, merely read the handbook and took an open book test and sat in a cockpit and learned the location of everything. And then it was time to go. Very quick and a lot of fun. The 82 was a good plane to land on a carrier. I went on one full cruise of 6 months and never got a wave off. And I was not, I was not the exception. It was just a neat plane on a carrier. And when I was a young pilot, I even took off with the flaps up by mistake. Still got airborne. And it was just fine.
Korea saw Sky Raiders thrown into conflict, where they played a major part in that war. Korea brought the world's remaining ideological camps into conflict. Remnants of the 1930s school of dictators would be swept under the skirts of one camp or the other for the next 40 years, and history would come to see the Cold War as a continuation of the Second World War. On the ground, there were times when battles resembled World War I, with the new American technologies of war pitted against infantry armed with rifles and trenches. The helicopter became a major weapon. United Nations air domination was, for most of the war, complete. the services of Korea's giant neighbor, China, effectively replaced North Korean forces because these had been destroyed. China is still coy about what it cost to maintain the line near the 38th parallel. But that line would hold, and the war would be settled with pens. The aerial war was shared between generations. Jets were deployed, but their need for long straight runways hampered their effectiveness, especially in the frantic early days of the war as the North Koreans swept the peninsula and captured all but the tiny pocket around Busan. The Air Force was hampered by having to fly from Japan with relatively short-range jets. The Navy's carriers were called on for a high proportion of support for the soldiers fighting desperately to hang on. Sky Raiders are essentially a big fighter plane. They don't have an internal bomb bay. This was not included for two reasons. One, additional weight in hydraulics and hinges for the doors. And two, it restricted the nature of the load. It was reasoned that strengthened wings with multiple mounts would accommodate a greater range of stores packages. In fact, the Sky Raiders would carry, at one time or another, the whole inventory, including weapons that were rumors or theories in 1944, when the plane was first drawn up. During the Korean War, Sky Raiders took part in highly secret experiments, carrying nuclear weapons. And later, in 1953, the AD-4D variant would be developed specifically for that purpose. But it would never be called on to deliver these weapons. It would make and polish its enduring reputation with a range of conventional stores. In the desperate days early in the Korean War, and later, as the fighting dragged on, the Sky Raiders were increasingly accepted as being the Navy's big punch. Their varied loads were delivered precisely and effectively, and could include rockets and napalm, and a range of small and large bombs to suit particular targets. Their loads had one other outstanding feature. They were enormous. On several occasions, a Sky Raider would deliver a weight of bombs that was greater than its own weight. Loads of up to 14,000 pounds were carried in a plane that weighed only 11,000 pounds. This was well outside the parameters of what could be expected from most other aircraft in service. And the longer the war went on, the more additional orders flowed into the Douglas factory. The orders had in fact been stockpiling due to delays in delivery. There was a series of problems with a new engine. There had also been problems with the introduction of the plane into service. The design team had expended a great deal of energy on minimizing weight. This led to some modifications to cure stress problems which had developed in the initial carrier trials of the plane. These problems were partly the result of poor landing technique. In response, pilots were given additional practice, while the Sky Raider was also strengthened to withstand heavier impacts. Most of the planes they served with in Korea were to be phased out rapidly. The jets, because of the rapid developments in technology, and the piston planes because of their age. The Sky Raider's future was also already being scrutinized in order to develop specifications for a replacement aircraft. The conclusion was a tribute to the big Douglas aircraft, because the Navy decided to buy three aircraft, splitting the roles performed by the Sky Raider to a range of airframes. In 1949, the future of the ADs could at best have been described as uncertain. Very few could have predicted they would endure long into the jet era. But orders continued, and when production eventually ceased on the 18th of February, 1957, 3,180 Sky Raiders had been built. It would be many more years before they would be found in museums.
When we would get back to Japan on rest and recreation, if we ever met Army people or Marines that had been on the ground up in the front lines and told them what we flew, they always said, "Well, you guys are the ones that saved our lives, and we wouldn't have your job for anything."
Oftentimes, we'd find, particularly a Vietnamese pilot who was rather short, that we'd have to put a seat cushion or a pillow behind them so we could move the Vietnamese pilot forward so that he could get full right rudder, particularly with a heavy load on a short runway where he needed full power instantly.
In September 1960, the first Sky Raiders arrived in a new theater of conflict, in a new role, as fighters to join the Vietnamese Air Force. In May, a further 25 arrived, where they became a major factor in the air war over Vietnam. United States' involvement with the Vietnamese Air Force grew, not only in supplying aircraft, but helping in many ways to tune the Vietnamese into a combat-ready force. In 1962, pilot training was transferred to the United States. Coincidentally, military aviation experimentation was being directed toward the question, what type of aircraft would best answer the tactical requirements in counterinsurgency operations? The answer was, an aircraft with the attributes of the Douglas Sky Raider. U.S. involvement with the Vietnamese Air Force had formally started in 1955, but it was not until the early 60s that U.S. advisors were sent to Vietnam in noticeable numbers. American pilots supplemented the locals. American administrators, ground crew, and trainers also multiplied, and the flow of aircraft continued. Also increasing through this time was the level of insurgent activity. The Saigon regime, riddled with corruption and badly out of touch with the population, was tottering along under Diem. The country was a breeding ground for civil discontent. Leaflet drops and aerial propaganda broadcasting were no answer to the situation. The flow of arms and then troops from the north made the situation in much of the south untenable. For military efforts to work, the nature of the regime would have to change, giving some recognition to the interests of the people. Sadly, Southern politics would be limited to a series of presidents. The system persisted. The only movement was a gradual decay that eventually became defeat. When they received their first Sky Raiders, the Vietnamese were disappointed. They had been expecting jets. However, the Geneva Agreement outlawed the introduction of such advanced weapons into the conflict. The Vietnamese Air Force would not get its first jets, Northrop F-5s, until 1967. In the interim, they used a variety of aircraft in well-organized and effective operations against the guerrilla forces. Spotters and attack aircraft worked together closely to provide powerful and precise support to ground operations. Under the close and often hands-on guidance of the U.S. Air Force advisors, the VNAF developed tactical responses to guerrilla operations that were to remain models for much of the war. Smoke markers fired by Cessna bird dogs operating as forward air controllers would indicate targets for the Sky Raiders. In 1962, the name of the Sky Raider changed again with a revision of Navy nomenclature to the A-1. The Sky Raider's third official designation actually suited the plane perfectly. A-1 was certainly an accurate description. Over the skies in Vietnam, Sky Raiders performed an outstanding role in counterinsurgency. And another customer, the United States Air Force, was soon to be flying them alongside the Vietnamese.
Commander-in-Chief, it is my duty to the American people to report that renewed hostile actions against United States ships on the high seas and the Gulf.
President Johnson's announcement after the Gulf of Tonkin incident was not actually the first American involvement in the Vietnam conflict. President Kennedy had promoted counterinsurgency as essential, and Air Force units had grown up around this specialty. Nor had they taken long to arrive in Vietnam with its long-running guerrilla war. Now they were joined by the full weight of the military, and the lessons they had learned were passed into operations on a far grander scale. With the formal commitment of United States forces came a transformation of the conflict. The entire conventional weight of the U.S. was committed in a guerrilla war. Helicopters would be the enduring image of Vietnam, as gunships, as troop carriers, and as rescue for downed pilots.
This is Bravo 8-1, airborne at flight of 16, event 101-4, over.
Bravo 8-1. This is Clearwater. Roger. Your pigeons to Point Cairo, 28014. Over.
This is 8-1.
The helicopters provided a focus for forces on the ground and became a persisting symbol of the conflict. The increasing weight of war machinery and new methods of employing it developed along with a bewildering series of political skirmishes. Together, these military and political developments gave new meaning to the expression, the futility of war. U.S. Air Force Sky Raiders had started Vietnam operations in May 1964 with Vietnamese observers who were nominally in charge of activity. The twin-seat A-1Es they used were to be the first of many U.S. Air Force Sky Raiders to serve in the theater. By the time the Es began to run out, the U.S. was fully involved, and they could be replaced with the still numerous single-seaters. The use of these planes alongside Mach 2 jets was not incongruous. It was a result of specialization.
Thank you.
Sky Raiders had exceptional attributes. The ground troops appreciated their heavy load of ordnance and the fact that they could loiter, waiting for work. Their pilots loved the accuracy that could be achieved when flying something as stable, slow, and maneuverable as their A-1s. They were also grateful for the armored toughness of the planes, which could absorb tremendous battle damage. In their long career, the Sky Raiders earned several nicknames. There was a drive to have them known as the Pulverizer, which never took. They were known after their call sign in Korea as ADs, which were able dogs. They also had other names. They were Spads, and in their rescue work, they were Sandy. Their activity in close support was unmatchable. They pounded away with an accuracy impossible with supersonic aircraft. They provided this service in virtually all weather. When the jets were grounded, the Sky Raiders were out there working. Admittedly, they offered a pretty good target. Someone who had been trying to hit a Mach 2 jet with the rifle would have welcomed the sight of a SPAD to shoot at. But the SPAD soaked up damage and kept on going. At least to the extent of getting home, even if they wouldn't fly again. U.S. Air Force lost 153 Sky Raiders in combat in Vietnam between 1962 and 1973. A further 41 were listed as operational losses. Considering the job they did, this is a testimony to the aircraft. 146 of the U.S. Air Force losses were caused by ground fire. Only three were lost to SAMs, two to MiGs, and two in attacks on airfields. This reflects the way they were used, in close support wherever the troops happened to be that day, or as escorts for rescue helicopters. Incredibly dangerous roles, day after day. Whereas the overall U.S. average of losses due to ground fire was 57%, for the Sky Raiders, the figure was 75%.
On one occasion, we had a four-ship of A-1Es land at Nha Nam Phanom. And between us four A-1s and the two helicopters, there were 619 holes in our aircraft. That's exciting. And it was immediate. And oftentimes it was dramatic, high drama over a long period of time.
Now we continue with Wings on the Discovery Channel. The twin-seat A-1E models that the Air Force had first taken out of Navy mothballs simply wore out. There comes a time in the life of an aircraft when the next rebuild cannot be justified, and the E models had come to that point. The U.S. Air Force would continue to use Sky Raiders, replacing the aging E's with the single-seat H model. The last E model flew its final mission on the 10th of April, 1967. And was hoisted aboard ship for its journey back to the USA. There was quite a bit of history in that moment. The nickname SPAD referred to a First World War biplane. At first, it expressed the scorn of the jet pilots for the lumbering old war horses that cluttered their airfields. However, the SPADs in Vietnam changed that scorn into grudging respect, and then into awe. In time, many of the jet jockeys would owe a great deal to the SPADs, because Vietnam had given the Sky Raiders a new task. Many knowledgeable people maintain that the SPADs found their finest hour in this new role: rescue helicopter escort. The rescue parties involved a variety of aircraft, control aircraft, spotters, the rescue choppers, and the pugnacious A-1s as escorts. The control aircraft would patrol at height, listening for the radio beacon of a downed pilot. After establishing the pilot's whereabouts, a rescue team would be directed to the area. Strike aircraft would also be involved in covering the operation, especially when the rescue was conducted deep inside North Vietnam. The work of these crews, in the helicopters and the other aircraft, required great courage. Despite the danger, the units pressed each mission as hard as possible, and in the course of the war, were credited with an amazing 3,833 rescues.
Rooster Lee, this is Crown One. We're verified at your identity. Sandy's are en route. We'll arrive in your area in 8 minutes. Jolly Green's in 19 minutes. We have called MCAP for you. It should be in your area by now.
Roger. I have tally-ho the MCAP. Thank you.
Stay in orbit over Red Rooster 2 until Sandy's arrived.
Roger, Crown. Roger, Crown. It's Sandy 1. Go ahead.
Red Rooster Lead is still orbiting over downed pilot at coordinates 1020 north, 10550 east. He has reported enemy automatic weapon fire 1 mile north of downed pilot. There may be a lot more around the pilot himself. Sandy 1, this is Crown. I am designating you on-scene commander. Take over.
Roger, Crown. I've got it.
Sky Raiders filled the role of escort well. They had the endurance to stay aloft for hours. They could quite happily hover along with the slow helicopters. At the location of a rescue, they could bring their firepower into play to suppress any hostile activity in the area, allowing the Jolly Greens to go about their business with little interference. For these missions, the Sky Raiders were fully loaded with ordnance and ammunition. Because of the vulnerability of the helicopters to ground fire, it was essential that enemy activity be suppressed before the choppers presented themselves as stationary targets hovering above the downed crew. As a result, the A-1s would engage in what was referred to as trolling for fire. This consisted of flying low and deliberately drawing fire from enemy guns near the scene. When these guns had been located and silenced, the air would be safer for helicopters. It did, however, make a Sky Raider a dangerous place to be. The rescue team's motto was, "That others may live." To that end, they were prepared to risk their lives. The parajumpers, the men who went down the wire to the pilot, were trained scuba divers in case the rescue took place over water. They were qualified parachutists and experts with small arms and hand-to-hand combat. They were also fully trained in first aid. With the rest of the crew, they faced the danger of flying low and slow in their chopper to the rescue site, often under intense fire. Then they left even the aircraft's limited safety to become dangling targets. But others may live.
The tremendous personal satisfaction I had out of seeing a guy step out of that helicopter was tremendous. It was a very exciting experience. From a tactical standpoint, a beautiful thing about the A-1 is that it could stay over the guy for hours on time. It had a versatile load with 15 external stations. You could put a wide variety of ordnance on the aircraft. So it meant that when you got airborne, you could be applied to a wide variety of targets and situations. The disadvantage to the A-1 is obvious, because while it was an airplane with tremendous staying power and time in the air, it was very slow. And as a result, it was a fairly easy target for less sophisticated automatic weapons and anti-air.
The Navy had apparently replaced the Sky Raider when it split the roles of the plane among three airframes. The Grumman Tracker was to take over anti-submarine missions and went into service in 1954. The 1952 Douglas SkyWarrior was to carry out long-range bombing, including nuclear bombing. And the Douglas Skyhawk, the superb A-4, was to do everything else. But no one had told the Sky Raiders. They were still there in 1964 when the carriers found themselves in Vietnam, still a standard medium attack plane. Certainly the other types were there as well, but mingling with the screaming jets of the Phantoms, Skyhawks, and Vigilantes was the throbbing piston engine roar of the Sky Raiders. They were an important part of the striking power of the carriers in the early years of Navy involvement, and their slow and accurate attacks brought huge bomb loads to targets with deadly effect. In contrast to their jet-powered comrades, they were likely to be found on their way back to the ship, quietly looking for targets of opportunity. Their accuracy, huge loads, and long range made them uniquely valuable. But all good things come to an end. If the production lines were not to be reopened for further construction, there were only the existing Sky Raiders. They were getting old, not just because of their date of manufacture, but because they were being worked so hard. What happens to a plane in combat is extraordinary, and the Sky Raiders were in the process of being replaced by a fourth aircraft, the Grumman A-6 Intruder. Although some were taken out of mothballs to be revitalized by the U.S. Air Force, the A-1s were being phased out of service, this time for real. On Sunday, the 20th of February, 1968, Lieutenant Theodore Hill landed his Sky Raider on the USS Coral Sea after completing a combat mission over Vietnam. He was 23 years old, and the Sky Raider had been in service for 23 years. He had just completed the last combat mission of U.S. Navy Sky Raiders. That was it. The old planes had finished their Navy service. No amount of polishing could extend their lifespan. They could still have been loaded with arms and sent on more missions, but it was time to call it a day. After a career as a full-time anachronism, the Sky Raider had finally earned a long overdue retirement. Their replacements were already in service. Indeed, some of their replacements were due for replacement themselves. Pilots had a love affair with their A-1s. They were disappointed that they had to give up the Spads. This was no reflection on their new planes, but there was simply no replacement for the seat of your pants flying, the ponderous but dynamic control, the stability, the leisure, the intensity of action, the accuracy and power of the Sky Raiders. They flew such long missions that the pilots often took their lunch with them. Substitutions were made for the Sky Raider, but there was never a real replacement.